Hi, my name is Mariana, and I'm going to tell you about the topic of my master's thesis. Before I go into it, though, I will first tell you why this topic is important.
You may have noticed that particle accelerators have been getting bigger and bigger, and of course more expensive, in the last half century. Take the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, for example. Even though its 27-kilometer circumference tunnel was already built, it still cost around 7.5 billion euros to build. It was worth it, though, because now we can accelerate protons to energies of 7 teraelectron volt, which means that each proton bunch carries, well, this much energy. But the next step for particle physicists is Large Hadron Collider, or LHC, for electrons and their antiparticles, the positrons, because they are fundamentally different from protons and their collisions can offer new insights. The snag is that you waste a lot of energy if you accelerate these light-charged particles in circles, like the LHC. So this electron accelerator would have to be straight, which makes this kind of project even more expensive than the LHC. One of the reasons for the high price tags for accelerators today is the technology we use to accelerate particles, radio frequency cavities. We apply an oscillating electric field to these metal cavities that is synchronized with the passing of each particle bunch. But we can only apply so much voltage, otherwise the material of the cavity will break. That means that if we can't turn up the voltage, then we have to make the acceleration length really long, so that our particles can achieve the goal energy.
So what if we could use a material that can stand much stronger electric fields? This material exists, though it's not really a material. It's a state of matter such as liquid, gas, or solid. Its name is plasma, and it's sometimes also called the fourth state of matter.
Let's look at this hydrogen gas. Plasma is what happens when you give a gas so much energy that its molecules get separated, and the electrons fly away from their original atoms. In a hydrogen plasma, all that is left is protons and electrons. Plasma is a sort of charged gas, and it's what's inside fluorescent lights and neon lights. But the thing is, you can't break plasma with too much electricity, because all the bonds between the particles are already broken. This means that we can apply really high electric fields to it and accelerate our particles to the desired energy in a shorter length.
This is the idea behind plasma wakefield acceleration. Here we have a neutral plasma with electrons and positive ions. We can assume that the ions don't move much, because they are at least 2,000 times heavier than the electrons. If we send a proton beam into this plasma, electrons will feel attracted to it and move towards it. At this point, there is an area behind the proton beam that is void of electrons and only has positive ions left in it. This space charge will attract the blown electrons towards the axis again, where they will overshoot. This happens again and again until we have a periodic succession of charged areas, and every time charges are separated, an electric field is generated. In the end, a so-called plasma wake is left behind the beam. If we now insert an external electron beam at exactly the right time, it will be trapped and accelerated by the wake behind the driver beam.
This is a bit like surfing in real life. To be able to catch a wave, you have to gain enough speed to keep up with it, and only then can you stand up and surf it. If you're too slow, the wave will just roll along without you. It's the same thing with our electrons. Our objective all along is to bring electrons to an energy of a few teraelectron volt, like the protons at the LHC. Plasma wakefield acceleration is a bit like a transformer. You give some input energy, and that energy gets transferred to the output. If we want the highest output possible, then we have to put in as much energy as possible as well. And right now, the most energetic particles in the world are the protons accelerated at CERN. This is why CERN was the place chosen to set up the Advanced Proton-Driven Plasma Wakefield Experiment, or AWAKE. However, the proton bunches supplied at CERN are pretty long at 12 centimeters, and bunches this long can't excite a wakefield effectively. At the moment, it is impossible to compress high-energy proton bunches, but it turns out that nature takes care of this problem for us. As the long proton beam enters the plasma and produces the electric field wave at the front, this wave affects the rest of the beam and gradually breaks it off into much smaller beamlets that can then excite larger wakefields. This is called the self-modulation instability. Here you can see a computer simulation of the process. The yellow part in the center is the proton beam, and the blue and gray clouds are the plasma wake, which grows in amplitude behind the beam.
Since we're talking about an instability and we can't control it directly, it is very important that we understand under which conditions it will develop and under which conditions it won't. This will be the objective of my thesis, to investigate how certain changes of the initial parameters of the experiment can influence the self-modulation instability, because we rely on it for the whole thing to work. If it does work, we may be able to build the next generation of electron-positron colliders 1,000 times shorter, and of course, cheaper. I hope I was able to get you at least a little bit as excited as I am about this topic. Thank you for listening.